Sounds like somebody's doing something over there too. Let there be light! God's creating something over there. So I want you guys to know I don't know if those people mean well or not. Honestly, I don't. I was thinking about this and I was talking about it with somebody and I was just trying to figure it out. You know what I mean? Just trying to wrap my brain around it, really analyze it and think, what do you think motivates people? You know what I mean? What's behind that kind of thing? You know? And I can't help but think, maybe I'm wrong. But I can't help but feel that there's some element of superiority that they feel. We've got the answer to God. And you are condemned unless you join us. They're proud. Somehow, they're proud that they are believers. And instead of inviting other people in with the same love that was extended to them, they use these threatening methods and hurtful and hateful messages. And what's funny is that they didn't do anything. They're no better than you. They're no better than you. They did nothing to deserve God's love. Do you understand that? Those bozos standing outside did absolutely nothing to deserve God's love. Do you understand that? They didn't follow some complex path and arrive through their wonderful achievements to becoming Christians. They did nothing. They're no different than you or me or anybody else. God extended his love to them. They did nothing. I read this devotional often in the morning. I have a book written by this guy. He's like a Franciscan monk or something. He's some really interesting insights. It's very, very cool stuff. And he wrote something about a week and a half ago that touches on this. And I love this. I want you to try to grasp this. It's kind of complex, but I hope you'll get it. He said one reason that a lot of people reject God's gift of salvation is because it says nothing about them. Is because they have no part in it. It's all God. Do you see what I'm trying to say here? So many people want to feel like they lift themselves up by their own bootstraps. Or that I'm superior because I have the presence of mind to choose God. No, you didn't choose him. He chose you a long time ago. You did nothing. You did nothing but let him love you. But so many people in their pride, in their arrogance, want to believe that it's somehow about them. That somehow they have to have some involvement in this salvation thing. They have to be worthy somehow. They have to prove their worth. It takes us all the way back to what we talked about at the beginning, isn't it? That whole idea of proving your worth, being worthy. None of us are worthy. Not the guys on the street, certainly not me, not you, nobody. Not some pastor of your church, not some missionary in the jungle. Nobody is worthy. Nobody can earn what God has freely given to you. No human being ever, who ever lived or ever will, is worthy of the gift that God gives you freely. It's a present. It's a gift. It's not about you. It's not about what you have done to deserve it. And I think that some of these kind of people think that somehow they're superior. They're better because they have the answer. Yeah, it's like the Pharisees. It's that concept of being better than the unwashed masses because they figured out some great religious truth. No, they're just as dumb as I am. The only difference is there isn't any really any difference. God loves them as much as he loves you and me. But the thing that I remember yelling yesterday as I was walking away from those guys is, God loves these people as much as he loves you. And that's what you should put on your sign. There's no reason to boast. There's nothing to brag about. There's nothing to brag about. Because we don't do anything except let it happen. How many of you, when you were kids and you sat at Christmas morning around the Christmas tree and you walked in and there were presents everywhere and your mom and dad said, here, open this, and you opened this beautiful toy and you loved it and you're like, okay, what do I have to do for this, Mom? What do I need to do, Dad, to keep this toy? I doubt any of you did that. You know why? Because it was a present and you understood that it was a gift. You understood that it was a present you didn't have to earn, you didn't have to buy, you didn't have to work for, you didn't have to be worthy of. It was a present. And God's gift of his son is a present. His desire for a relationship with you is a gift that he's giving to you and me because his love for you is more important and greater than the judgment and the fear and the condemnation. And I really believe with my whole heart, if people knew that to be true, if people understood that, a lot more people would embrace it. But there are a lot of Christians out there that don't represent that very well. Did you know Gandhi, we're talking Gandhi, right? Amazing human leader. Gandhi said once, I would be a Christian if it weren't for all the Christians I know. Wow, how telling is that? But that's the sad truth. I've probably rattled on long enough. But I want you to take just this idea away with you. God loves you, period. There is no condition. There is no asterisk, ellipsis, you know what I mean? There is no, God loves you, yes, if, but, no. God loves you, period. And he wants a relationship with you, and you were made for that. You were designed to have a relationship with him. You may not know it, but you were. There is something in you, you may not even understand it, because there's so many loud noises in your life and it's drowned out. It's drowned out by all the noise in your life. But there's something inside you that wants a relationship with your Creator. And he's longing for that. And the good news today is that all you have to do is accept the present. You don't have to jump through any hoops. You don't have to join any church. You don't have to put your hand on any Bible and swear an oath. You don't have to prick your finger and sign anything in blood. You don't have to cut your hair. You don't have to throw away your anime collection. You don't have to unpierce your body. You don't have to stop getting tattoos. You don't have to change your wardrobe. Just let God in. Just let him in. Just accept his gift. And you know what? Everything else falls into place. I hope that you will take that and internalize it and bounce it around your mind and your heart a little bit today or tomorrow. It will change. It will change your life in a good way. Because you could be no better place in your life than in a relationship with the one who created you. There is no better place you could be in your life than walking alongside the one who loves you more than anything, who will never forsake you based on your scales of good and bad. He's not gonna leave. He ain't leaving. People in your life will fail you. People in your life will abandon you. It's a harsh truth, but it's true. I'm sorry. I've been abandoned. People failed me. I've failed people. And you probably have too. But God will never fail you. He will never walk away from you. He will never throw up his hands in disgust and say, "Oh, that's the last straw. You did that? Oh, no. Deal's off." The deal will never be off. And that's the good news. And you can walk through your days. You know, the Bible says where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. Where God is, there is freedom. You know why? You know why there's freedom? Because you don't have to walk a tightrope. Because you don't have to be afraid you're going to screw up and lose the deal. If you're never going to lose it, if you don't have to walk every day in fear that you're going to mess up, that's the freedom, right? If you were always afraid that you were going to screw up and God was going to walk away, that's the slavery. That's not freedom. That's the opposite of freedom. True freedom is knowing that you can stumble and fall and stand back up and God is right there. And you can do something dumb and go, "Oh, so dumb." And God's like, "It's okay. I understand. I'm right here. I love you. Let's keep going." I know I've kind of been all over the map today, but I hope that maybe I've shared something with you that you'll consider. And I'm gonna end with this. And this is a little bit hard to say. I think one of the reasons that I was so emotional with those people yesterday is because that's the kind of church I grew up in. They meant well. I can't speak for these guys, but I grew up in a church. I remember standing on street corners with kids from my church when I was 15 years old and passing out pamphlets about how you were going to hell. And I look back on that now and I think, how did we ever think that was going to draw people in? Who would ever think that would do it? Does it sound like God? Does it even, in your gut, in your heart, does it even sound like a loving God that He would draw you by fear? By terrifying you? That doesn't make sense, you know what I mean? But, you know, this is a long time ago. 40 years ago. The church that I grew up in, that was the way they thought. Like, we got to let people know, man, they're going straight to hell. We got to get out there and let them know that God's going to judge them and that, you know, they're going along in their life and they think everything's cool and it doesn't. And it seemed to make sense at the time when I was young. And my grandfather was the pastor of our church and I loved him. And I know that man and I know that his heart was in the right place. I know that he meant well. I know that he wanted to reach people. But for many decades, that was the way people thought you were supposed to reach people, is to scare the crap out of them. And now over the years, as I've gotten older, much older, I feel like I understand better. That it's your kindness, Lord, that leads us to repentance. That you didn't send your son into the world to tell the world how bad they were, but to give them a chance and hope and a way back to you.